Beek. Okay. So, my name is Frank van Geffen, and as I'm not told, the first process mining camp I kicked off, and it's a nice pleasure to be able to finish these practice talks this day. I've evolved my workings to, like say, process innovator, because when I started with process mining, it was the end of 2008, and you saw at the graph that Anna showed you this morning, there are innovators, early adopters, the early majority, and the rest. Well, I think I consider myself as an innovator. I try to share with the people who were at my workshop some of the, say, like experiences that I've had in these six years. And I hope also that they got a feel of what I experienced. I will also show you some of this today. I'm also the chairman of the special interest group on process mining in the Netherlands. So it's from the NGI NGN platform. So together with Will van der Aalst, we produced this this nice issue, specially devoted to process mining. Very proud of that, that we did that. And I'm a member of the task force on process mining and try to do my thing for the worldwide dispersion of process mining. So I work at the Rabobank. Well, I will show you some figures and some values of our bank. I think this provides for a good basis for innovation also. Somebody asked me why is the Rabobank able to adopt these kinds of technologies, these kinds of innovations, and I think the most important thing is that we are very involved in what we do. We try to acknowledge our cooperative identity also in the way that we do our work. Sometimes it slows down the process, but in many cases it provides for a lot of opportunity to innovate and also to adopt this innovation. So I will tell you the success of process mining at Rabobank. I will go into what happened so far, so from the point in 2012 until now, and I will give a short glimpse of what we are heading to. And then I will show some examples of the cases, projects that we did at Rabobank. And these examples I showed a lot this year, past year, because they really show well how you can create business value with this process mining technique. And last but not least, I will share what, in my opinion, makes for this success, because it's not always the hard factors of data that is not available, or tooling that you don't have, or money that you don't have, because I experienced all these situations. I had the tooling and not the money, and I had the money and not the data, etc. So I will sum this out. So what happened after I ended my presentation in 2012? Well, there was a project manager on big data, and he said, well, I'm doing a proof of concept on big data, and well, you told me about this tool, this process mining tool. Could it be that we could work together? I think I have a nice case, and maybe we could do a proof of concept on this big data platform. I said, well, I think it's a good match because you have the data, I have the tool, so let's do it. And I ended my presentation by saying, become a sponsor. Who wants to become a sponsor? Well, at this point in time, we had already had an innovation cycle and nobody became a sponsor. So it was not adopted. So we really needed to have another innovation cycle to get to the level of sponsorship that really made a difference, say, within adoption of at Rabobank. So from the end of 2012, we had this pilot case on our service desk, and this process has been presented here a few times already today. So also we took this process of our IT service desk to really look at the range of possibilities that big data could provide. We looked at who called, what do these agents fill in when they have the caller online? So the scripts they work out, and we did some text mining and data mining. And if a call is not answered, what happens then? And it becomes an incident. And we looked with this process mining techniques, and already the tool Disco was available at this point in time. And we really got a good feel of what happens when a customer or an internal employee calls the service desk. What happens then? And this led to, say, like a grand business case. At this point in time, we convinced, like say, the management of the service desk to, on the basis of a benchmark we made, to really invest in process mining projects. We set up a project team with, on the one hand, a lean consultant, on the other hand, a process miner and a data provider. We also had, like say, these data scientists or the database administrators to help us just make sense of some of the data. And we went on. I will show you an example later on, and this slide will come back in the further, so you can really see where we're at now and what the results were. Then we also had a spillover, because this manager of this service desk had a lot of influence within the IT department, and he also influenced our business department. I talked to one of the business owners here, and I said, well, I have here a site, and I can show you on this site exactly from all the customers which routes that they took and where they ended and where it took long. And he said, well, I have never seen this before. I don't have this. I have some client panel, and they look at how we design our internet sites, and they give a like or not. And there are 12 panelists who come to our user experience laboratory, and they say something, and well, then we design this internet site, and we never know exactly what happens. And now you are showing me exactly what these customers are doing on our internet site. So these two, they came together, and they say, well, we need to apply this on our core banking processes. So we did, and we called this step change or customer insight research. And we started really looking at what are our customers doing in our process and how efficient, effective are they. We coupled it to our corporate strategy. So we have a vision until 2016 and further. And we say, well, we could do a lot here. We were really active in the C of check and the A of act, because the insights are not alone. You need to come with action to really experience the benefits of a process mining analysis. So at this point in time, I've shown you a map. And this map, you don't need to read it, but it's like a tool we use in our ICT department to manage the use of applications. And it's also a means to say, well, this domain is a little further in its maturity than another domain. If you talk to them, maybe you'll get a feel of what you are trying to achieve, and maybe we can get some learnings over and through, and then maybe you can also apply process mining effectively. And what this map shows us is that everybody in the Rabobank group, in the group, not only the Netherlands, but the complete group internationally also, is aware and is interested in applying process mining. A couple are further in their maturity, so are repeatedly applying process mining for improving their processes. So what I do by using this map at this point in time is trying to mature the use of process mining within the Rabobank, applying, like say, intervention tactics to, well, speed up the use and speed up the value that we can get out of it, and raise the awareness. So my goal would be to, like say, getting more of the departments of Rabobank to get from the stage of interest to the stage of evaluating to the stage of adopting. Well, it's going very fast. Well, this is a picture. Also not really readable, but I will explain what's on this picture. At this point in time, we are applying process mining on a project-based application with business consultants and lean consultants. So we are applying it in Lean Six Sigma projects and in standalone research. But we are also applying it for regular analysis, so this repeatable form, which Anna also told you about, and in a kind of a more reporting manner. So these are two usage in which we say, like, provide this, our organization with the use of this tool. But the next step is, say, like, you have these, you have the business intelligence community, you have the say the process management, the process analyst, designers community, and both claim at this point in time, well, we know how to help you. We can create the perfect dashboard, or we have the intelligence that you need. Well, I think that these two should merge and come up with, say, like, the new form of intelligence that the real organizations at this point in time need. And that's also what I saw today. I think also in the talk of Nicholas is that you are able to use all these mining techniques, all these analysis techniques to really create this business value. And where we're moving to is like a situation where if these two domains are merged, you get the real, say, like, self-learning systems, like all these artificial intelligence promises that are made at this point in time. Real-time process mining of real-time process control. That is where we're heading, because we now are able to discover all the rules and decisions that are made in reality. And if we are providing those rules to learning algorithms and implementing them back into our sites, we can get intelligence websites that help the customer even further in his experience. But we are at, like, say, a plateau. We have reached, in my opinion, the max of what we can get out of process mining from a performance perspective. So, and on the one hand, we joined up with our audit group to exploit also, say, like, the functionalities for audit, because we at Rabobank haven't exploited that part very deep, and start developing new skills there. So this is like a new plateau on which we could use also this process mining capability. But for the others, well, we need to develop some new skills. For that reason, we also are looking to these, say, joining of these different analysis techniques, because searching for causes, etc. I think it's still a difficult one to really do that data-driven. You saw that in the other presentations, you need lots of data sources put together, and then maybe you can objectively point at the cause. So, well, the best way to predict the future is to create it. Thanks, Rudy. And, well, we also are looking into this bowl of predictive analytics and what I said, real-time process control. And that's, I think, the plateau we're going up right now to create, like, say, innovation pilots and innovation cases to do this. To really use what we've developed with process mining to, well, accelerate, like, say, the intelligence that we could push into the organization. Okay, and that's like simulation, complex event processing, predictive modeling, etc. I want to start now by explaining some examples, because also we started somewhere. And then a question was during the workshop, what's the best process to start? Well, in my opinion, the processes that have had the most success are the call center processes. So they provide for a nice, neat, structured environment with good logging and a culture in which people are open for improvement. So they are already being pushed to perform better. So it's like, if you want to do performance analysis, a call center is a good place to start. And also all the other presentations of today show that this is a good environment. So also we did that in one of this, well, like, say, internal call center cases. This is where we have a defect of a monitor in our office building. So a monitor breaks, somebody calls the service desk. Somebody comes and checks if the monitor needs to be repaired, or if not, he takes it away and puts down a new one. It's a very simple process. So what we do at Rabobank, we put together the people that are involved in this process, so as well as the call center agents, as the provider of the solution, and we ask them, how long do you think this takes on average? And then you get like all kinds of numbers, and then we present the real average from the data. So they get on edge. They think, wow, okay, 8 days. I thought so, or well, that takes long, or well, I don't think that's very long. And next, we ask them, count how many steps this would take. And I also always say then, it's not purely the amount of steps, but also the sequence in which they are taken, and the amount of repeatable steps. And we do this not with these pictures, it's 11 steps, but with these. So here we have, like say, a simplified view on this process, and we immediately see where the rework is situated. And we see that there's some rework extra at the call center, there's some rework extra at the supplier side. And we ask, we can zoom in on all these individual cases, and all the people that have worked, or the most people that have worked on these cases, are in the room. We then ask, what's happening here? The supplier says, I don't have enough information, so I send this incident back immediately. The call center says, yeah, I don't know exactly where this monitor is, and there's no information provided in the call which I can send with the incident. So there's like an information shortage, and somebody says, yeah, well, there's been a movement in all these monitors, and they forgot to put on these stickers. And these stickers, this one I have on my laptop, have all the information of these monitors. And if they just put this information in with the incident, our supplier exactly knows which monitor it is, where it's at, and what's wrong. And the real solution that they came up with during this discussion was, the supplier said, well, we have a completely automated system. We can detect if a monitor is defect on from our site. So we don't have to come over. We just sense, we can automatically see if this, which monitor is defect, and determine if it needs to be repaired. And also that we can do from our own site. And if it needs to be replaced, we know exactly which monitor it is, and we are coming to replace it. So this is almost gone. They really reduced, like say, the need to call the call center by automating, like say, the repairs of monitors. And this one is interesting, because this one we did not expect. And this one is like say, the person that fills the holes. So if nobody acts, he or she acts, because he can't stand it that the customer, I as an employee, cannot work because not the monitor is defect. So this is also common in most processes. You see that they are compensating for inefficiencies. And it's nice that you can objectively point at that. So it's not in every case a bad thing that this is happening, but well, it's nice to see that you can objectively point it. So the overall business case that was made, and the point that we are at, is that we after 6 months, we have reduced the waiting times with 72,000 hours. We have reduced the number of steps taken in the service desk with 28,000, and we prevented 2,000 incidents. Purely on the basis of this, of these insights and projects. And the complete business case that was made was, we can save 500,000 hours and 300,000 steps. So we are well on our way. And this is, like say, common in these kinds of environments, is that they are continuously trying to improve the service they can provide to callers and customers. The second one I want to show you is we apply process mining for, like saying, seeing the effect of a change. Because we know what the process is, this is how it's going until a certain point in time, and the process you are looking at is the refund of expenses. So if I want to get a refund of the trip I took here from Culemborg to Eindhoven, I send in a refund request, and this is the process that happens when I will get my money back or not. And it takes about 265 hours and 11 days. And this is until somewhere in September 2013. Then they decided, well, the main bottleneck here is an obligatory control or check. And what would happen if we would make the check optional? So they estimated, well, it would be an enormous gain in this process, because a lot of these incidents or these refunds don't have to go through this obligatory check. So they did that, and the average amount of steps here was 3, so it was not that much. But what they did was they split up this check. They made one optional check and one path that was straight through. So they don't need to check this path. The most cases are on this path. If you look very carefully, you see it light up. It's so fast that it's relatively not visible. And the fewer cases are here. They go through this optional check. Well, they reduced the amount of time from 265 hours to 29 hours, 1.2 days. Well, and we can objectively measure this. Well, I have still only 5 minutes, and I have so much to talk to you about. So I will go on a little quicker. Questions can also be asked after this presentation, during the coffee or the dinner. So we also applied this then on our primary banking process, our mortgage processes. And you have here this traditional channel, this online channel. And what we did was we wanted to give our customers the ability to give information on their application of a mortgage. And usually we go through this the banking channel, say the physical channel, to an office, make an appointment, and hand over papers, etc. Here they can scan them in and deliver their information on the internet. So what we wanted to measure was, is there a difference in which route that they take to get to this new internet functionality? Or do they stick in this channel? What is the usage of this new browsing functionality? And how many clients really get an offer and approve the offer? So buy a mortgage. Well, the reality is very complex. Every customer almost takes their own path. But through the focus of these questions, you can relatively easily see what the distribution is from the bank to online 58. But we saw that it took about 10 days on average to get an appointment, dispersed over all the local banks. So there were banks that took 30 days and banks that took 2 days. And the first time right in uploading documents, so the usage of this browsing was shockingly low. Well, I just got some figures on the improvement, and it's improving, but not that quick as we would like. So what makes process mining a success? And then I will go on to the end. Well, I explained in my workshop, it started with my personal belief that this could make a difference. And if you don't have that belief, you can stop now. Start small, think big. So look for these small starting examples, but have a vision on where it's going. And my vision was, like, say, process intelligence and really having more tools to do a real good process analysis. That was what, and having your processes in control. That's what my driving force was. Explain what's happening through a paradigm shift. So, a couple of presentations mentioned this already. But what we are doing is providing facts. We have a full case range, so all the cases that go through the process today, they are real. So these registrations have really happened, and the analysis is fast. And explain what this could mean for the decision making. Also, that speeds up, so you are able to become more agile. The sponsorship should come from that belief that it will yield these results. So, if I can convince a sponsor that my insights are really yielding the action that he wants, then he will sponsor me. Telling the story of success. Well, I think I have over more than 100 presentations on process mining already. And I've built up, say, like all the stories that we have experienced over a couple of years, and still I'm talking passionately about the success. If you don't have somebody that's doing that in your organization, it will slowly die. Marketing and selling the results. One and very important aspect is in the marketing and selling, integrated in what you already are doing. Don't reinvent the wheel. It's not that new. It's just a drill for a carpenter. A very powerful drill or a very powerful hammer. But we have already done process analysis for years. So just try to integrate it in what you are doing already. So it will also, you will also experience that it then naturally follows the goals you have as for an organization. It's a team effort, so don't think you can do it alone. You have these multiple disciplines to really get these actions and these results. And if you want to know what team members you need, you can ask. It's not a problem. Persistence in digging for data. So don't stop if they say that there is none. Because what we experienced was that all the data warehouses that we had did not have any process instance information. Not any. But we dug deeper and saw, well, it's just production. It's simple production data before it is exported to the data warehouse. So if you start there and you tap off there, you have the right data. So it's just look further and do not stop that easily. And transparency, that becomes very important if you do a lot of these kinds of processes or analysis with data. You need to be transparent about privacy and ethics. If you don't, it will backfire. I assure you. So these are, say, like, the more soft items that really makes a success. And what I also try to explain in the workshop is all also a bit of luck. So it is also that there is some click somewhere in a point of time. Because before 2012, I also had some 34 presentations, even more passionate maybe than now. And nobody wanted to join me. So it's also a bit of, well, bringing the elements together and applying and finding the right people that want to sponsor you. So if there are any questions, then maybe you can answer them now.
Let's take one question. Yes, please.
What problems did you come up with?
How do you mean problems?
In trying to implement the project plan.
Every problem you can think of. Just try to implement an innovation, and you know what the problems are you get. So if it doesn't fit in your existing business model,
need convince people that they either adjust their business model or develop a new one. And that's a very, very difficult problem. If it fits in your business model, then there is a mindset, well, we don't lock this data. We never say like steer our processes on these KPIs. So why should we do now? Why should we get our processes in control even more? Because we have never done this. But like there's a complete culture of like a functional hierarchical organization that if you analyze processes, yeah, well, you get to the point that it's going over these different departments. And you have to have somebody that thinks in processes. And that's like saying, well, if you do process management, well, you have problems. If you do process mining, you have even more problems. And if you connect two, well. But I think this holds also for the complete big data hype that's now on. Because I can say, we can see when somebody is going to divorce. We can actually see that. Why don't we act? I can see that this process is inefficient. Somebody has acted at this point in time and fired some people. But if I can predict that somebody will go, will divorce, I may not actively, proactively give some advice. Well, maybe it's a good thing to contact or, well. So for all these initiatives, we are going to, like say, run into the same challenges that somebody has to believe in. Somebody really wants to change this. And then we still also have this ethical discussion of, do we really want to do this? Do we really? And that differs also per country in the world. So, well, all kinds of problems. A very concrete one is that we started a project and we had this goal, we had this sponsor and this money and all the tools were in place, the resources, everybody was ready to go and the log file wasn't on. So we had to wait for a couple of weeks to build up history and then we could, all these different situations. And still sticking to it because I just strongly believe that this is a real revolutionary instrument to gain insight and to really say, well, for us as a banking industry, we really have to evolve at this point in time. If we don't, we die. And this is like a technique that can help us gain insights in all these traditional banking processes and try to, well, sometimes the hard way, force a change. It's not in any case that nice. I think it's needed also.
Okay, so let's continue in the break and get some coffee. Thank you.